Morning and welcome to Story Hill Church Online. We are so excited that you have chosen to join us this morning. My name is Aaron. I'm one of the pastors here. And officially, Happy Palm Sunday. We are 1 week away from Easter Sunday, and we are so excited. We just wanted to say thank you, no matter where you are, the situation that you have been walking through the last few weeks. We are here for you, praying for you, and honestly, we're just so excited that we get to gather corporately, even though it's digitally kind of separated right now, but we still are connected in so many different ways, and we get to enjoy this together today. So join us as we worship Jesus this morning. Thank you.
And as like Aaron said, it is Palm Sunday, and I love Palm Sunday. It's one of my favorite stories in the Bible because it's Jesus returning to this city where people think that it's time, the Messiah is in. In Luke 19:37-40, this is the story. Now he came near the path down the Mount of Olives, and the whole crowd of disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. The King who comes in the name of the Lord is the Blessed One. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. Now some of the Pharisees from the crowd told him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And Jesus answered them, "I tell you, if they were to keep silent, the stones would cry out." This morning is our time to sing to a King who deserves so much more. And if we're silent, the stones will cry out His greatness. So this morning, join us in singing and making a joyful noise to Jesus our King.
Every part of our faith.
Serve a great and gracious God, and God is so good to us. In His goodness, He gave us the way to come back in, because in our selfishness, we decided to walk away from God. And here at Story Hill, we think that it's important for us to acknowledge our brokenness together. And so before we continue worshiping, we're just going to do a quick prayer confession. So I ask you guys to take a moment, take a deep breath, and ask the Spirit to search your heart and just hear these words as I pray them over you. Gracious and merciful God, we confess to you our lack of faith. You have saved us by grace, but we still try to earn your favor by our works. You have met our deepest needs in Christ, but we still doubt your fatherly care. You have given us your Spirit, but we still walk according to the flesh. Forgive our lack of faith and strengthen us by your grace, that we may rejoice in you and bring you glory. Amen. Let's continue to sing about the promises that Jesus gives to his people.
Dry and weary land where there is no water. Oh, my soul is thirst for you. In a dry and weary land where there is no water. Oh, my flesh is faint for you. To your sanctuary I'll go. Your power and glory to behold. My soul be satisfied in you. My lips with joy will sing. My soul be satisfied in you. For your love is better than I'm
It's a weird time that we're living in right now. I know that there's a lot of fears out there, a lot of kids, a lot of anxiety, a lot of unknowns, but God, thank you for your truth. God, that we can rest in just the fact that you are in control of it all, that you are faithful. God, we ask that you would truly satisfy us this morning. God, that when we leave the service, that we would feel connected to you and feel filled with your spirit. Jesus, I ask that you would open our hearts this morning and allow us to just be fully here and present and enter into what you have for us. God bless Brandon as he brings your word. And we're so, so thankful for what you've done for us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Guys, good morning. Thanks again. Thanks so much for jumping on with us here at Story Hill Online. It is a new format for us. We're still getting used to all the kinks, but we're so excited about the opportunity that we even have to jump into your living room from where we are and share God's word and share what God is doing at Story Hill. And it has been such a cool experience for us to be able to do that. So again, just welcome. I hope you're doing well where you are. I hope you guys are staying safe out there. And please be letting us know if there's any way that we can be praying for you, that we can be encouraging you. We want to continue to be the church and help as you guys are in need. So, again, just love you guys so much. Miss you a lot. And can't wait until the day comes where it's safe for us all to be back together. So, guys, today I have the privilege to wrap up our Titus series. We're going to finish up the book today. And we have a couple unique, difficult passages to work through. We're going to try to move pretty quickly. So be ready, be taking some notes, be taking pictures of the screen if you need to. It's going to be a fast-paced, a great morning. So really quick, the first thing I wanted to start off with is just a reminder that Titus has been about what we are supposed to be as the church in a culture that is not like Jesus. Because obviously for us to be set apart, for us to model Jesus who is not of culture, for us to be able to do that, there have to be some specific guidelines for us to follow, some things that God has asked us to do and some things that he has asked us not to do. And the reason for all of that is so that we can take those things and point people's attention back towards Jesus. Not towards culture and towards the idols of the world, but towards a God who desires to save his people. And that's why God has called us to be set apart and to live differently. And so Titus is a book that is a letter that was written from Paul to one of his missionaries that he's trained up, and he's sent to the island of Crete to love those people who are in a lost and broken culture, seeking love from all kinds of different things, but where Titus is to plant himself firmly and go, listen, guys, the only hope is Jesus. I want to look back last week at a few of the verses that we covered because it kind of builds off of where we start today. So if you'll read with me, we're going to start in verse 4. And it says this, "But when the kindness of God, our Savior, and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not by works of righteousness that we have done, but according to his mercy, through the washing of regeneration and renewal by the Holy Spirit,
He poured out His Spirit on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. So that, having been justified by the grace of Jesus, we may become heirs with the hope of eternal life. This saying is trustworthy, and I want to insist on these things so that those who have believed God might be careful to devote themselves to good work. These are good and profitable for everyone. And guys, I really believe, like, we could probably just sit here and read this over and over for the rest of the morning, and that would be good. What an amazing message that God is trying to encourage us with through Paul. Listen, this is how it's supposed to work. God reveals Himself to us. And He is a God that loves us so much that He could not dare for us to spend our lives drowning in our own sin. So instead, He sent Jesus, and Jesus came and gave His righteousness to an unrighteous people so that we, broken and messy, could be reunited to a loving God. And we could be given the gift of communion and unity once again with God. Guys, what's so crazy is that even more than that, more than this gift of reconciliation, God has seen through it that His people will not only be saved from their sins, but will also be rewarded with eternity and perfection with Him. Guys, that is the good news, and that is the gospel message. That is the glory that God has revealed to us, His plan for salvation for a broken and messy people. And of course, you know, upon hearing such good news, He says that it should be our goal to be running around in the streets and in our neighborhoods and at our workplace and in our homes, treating people with love and kindness and paying forward this good grace that we've been shown. That right there, that is how our time is to be spent, and that is how we will all do good and be profitable until the return of Jesus. And so obviously we read those things and we look back over the history of the church and you're like, the church has never dropped the ball. We've never made a mistake. We've never been divisive. There's never been tension. We've done it perfectly since Paul wrote that message in Titus, right? Of course not. We have all experienced brokenness inside and outside of the church in our own lives and in the lives of others. We have not gotten this right. And so this message is deeply important for us to hear how they instruct us to move forward in this. And this was the same for the people that Paul was writing to. And so he warns them. Paul warns Titus in verse 9 that they're not always going to get it right. We are not always going to be the model that we're supposed to be in the church. So verse 9 we pick up today and it says this. It says, but avoid foolish debates, genealogies, quarrels, and disputes about the law, because they are unprofitable and worthless. Again, after telling us a command of what we are to do, of how we're to be profitable and how we're to do good, it gives us a warning about ways that we can really mess that up. In the first place that they start is, listen, by being arguers of things that don't matter. Growing up, my little sister and I loved to argue. And I think it's obvious to say that being brother and sister, older brother, little sister, we're already destined to argue, but we're also very different kids with very different ways to process information and ways to go about the world, and me being more stoic and serious and her loving life and taking the long way through a conversation. And we were destined to be fighting. But we would fight about the dumbest things, like what color is the sky at night? Is it black or is it purple or is it blue? Or it had to be one of those definitively, and she couldn't be right because I had to be right, and I couldn't be right because she needed to be right. And in that moment, there was nothing more important than being right, than proving to her that I was the big brother and she was wrong. But when I back away and I look back at how silly those things were, the reality was is that I loved her. And she loved me. And our time could have been so much better spent on relationship building instead of arguing over dumb things that kids love to argue about. But the reality is that as adults, as Christians,
we can be just like that. We can get into silly conversations over and over again that cause dissension and division in our churches and our communities. And instead of being in a place where we are providing family and comfort and safety for people, we can become a place that is harmful and divisive. Our churches have been splitting for centuries over the kind of music that the church plays, over the color of the carpet and what picture should be in the lobby, of ridiculous things that are splitting churches apart, instead of us uniting together to pursue this image that Paul is trying to paint for us of what it looks like to be the church. Unfortunately, some of you have experienced some really divisive churches, and you have seen firsthand what it's like to have a church family ripped apart over arguments. Guys, a divided church has never been God's desire. God painted this picture, and especially in the book of Acts, of a church lovingly pursuing Him and working together to make sure that everyone had what each other needed and watching out for one another and being family. Because if we can't watch out for each other, no one else is going to take the time to watch out for us. It is so important for the body to be together, and a divided church has never been God's desire. And I don't want us to get it backwards. There are some things in the church that are tremendously important for us to be fighting over. There are some things that we have to be in agreement on. Things like maintaining that Jesus was Lord and not just a good man. Things like that salvation is only possible through faith in Jesus. That the perfect union of the Trinity must be preserved. That the need for confession and repentance is necessary to be present in all of our lives as believers. The list goes on. And it's all of these things that we read about week in and week out as we try to teach God's Word here at Story Hill. I was talking with this with Jeff Roberts, one of our elders, earlier this week, and he used the phrase that you may be familiar with. It said that we don't want to major in the minors, meaning that we don't want our obsession and our focus to become on the things that aren't tremendously important. There are so many things for the church to be focused on, and we can get caught up in all of the little details. So how do we keep the major and not major in the minors? We have to become more knowledgeable about what the Bible really says, and we have to keep our hearts close to the conviction and the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. It's necessary. Guys, it's also worth noting that this isn't about your opinion. This is about the truth of God's Word. This isn't a disagreement on whether or not the pastor should be able to have a beard or not. Silly, but true story. Paul is writing about people who are stirring up theological untruths and making them a big deal in the church. Paul is warning against people who are committing heresy against God's truth. It isn't so much simply about arguing and being divisive, it's also addressing the heart behind why there is division and why there is argument. In Matthew 22, there's this really great example of this, and you guys maybe remember this from when we talked through Matthew a while back, but there's this point where the Pharisees or the Sadducees have cornered Jesus, and they're pressing him to answer a really challenging question. They're saying, listen, Jesus, you talk about the resurrection, and you talk about marriage and all these other things. Let me ask you a question then. If a woman is married, and her husband dies, and she marries his brother, and he dies, and so she marries the other brother, and he dies, and this goes on for seven brothers. When they get to heaven, who will that woman be married to? And that can seem like a harmless question if we're not really studying in behind this, because that could be a legitimate question that their heart is searching after. Lord, teach me what I'm supposed to know in this. But as we read the context, we know how the Sadducees and Pharisees were after Jesus. We know that this is a trap to try to draw him into an argument of one, either saying that polygamy is allowed in heaven, or to give them evidence to prove that resurrection isn't real. See, their heart behind the division is to draw people to their side, to make themselves right and other people wrong, specifically Jesus. And he does this amazing thing in how he answers. In Matthew 22, verse 32, he says this, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac.
am the God of Jacob. He is not God of the dead, but of the living. And I love what he's pointing out in this, because first off, before that happens, he says, listen, marriage is of the least of your concerns in eternity. It is so far beyond anything that you could possibly imagine that the fact that you're focused in on whether or not marriage will exist in it, it's such a small reality compared to the grandness of what eternity and perfection will be like with Jesus. But then he turns it on to them and he says, listen, God's the God of the living, not the God of the dead. And what he means by that is, listen, you're worried about things that are going to happen after you die, and you're not even paying attention to things right now that God is calling you to pay attention to while you're alive. God is the God of your present, not just of your future. There's a couple things I think we can learn out of that. One thing is, I want to make kind of a quick warning in the season that we're in right now in life, is we're not in the workplace, we're not all these other places. We're spending more time online than ever. And in this moment, we have maybe more of a social media presence than any of us have ever had. And that's proven by all these ridiculous videos that continue to pop up all across the internet of people trying to find what to do with their time. But I want to ask this question, as we are focusing on those things and we are representing the church in an online presence, what does your social media say about your heart as far as it's concerned with who God is in your life? Even online, even on Facebook, even as you're blowing off steam from being caught up in all of this isolation, does your social media presence point to God being Savior of your life? Or have we fallen victim in some areas of causing division and causing dissension and trying to tear people apart by furthering our own agenda instead of pressing towards peace of God and the truth of God? Here's another thing I want to think about. We need to note very carefully the kind of sin that's being called out in this passage in verse 9. One of the commentaries I love to read, the exposition commentary, says this: note carefully the sin we confront. The sin is public, it is habitual, it is serious, and it is lacking repentance. We are not called to be the spiritual garbage inspectors or theological peeping toms. And I love the way that they phrase that, because it's very in your face, but it's saying, listen, as we work on not getting into silly arguments, it is not your job to go through people's garbage and try to find something to confront them about. It's not your job to spy into the intimate moments of people's life and try to dig out something that you can find evidence so that you can call them out. Now, if something does come to light, the Bible's going to tell us what it is that we're supposed to do about that. But the preface to this is, these are sins that have become public and are habitual, and the person is refusing to repent from those. That's the kind of stuff that these Pharisees continue to model, the Sadducees, these arguments with Jesus, and that's what Paul is warning Titus about at the church in Crete. So what do we do in those kind of moments where we find that division and those arguing over silly things? Verse 10 says this: reject a divisive person after a first and second warning. So it says at least two times. Once, go to that person and say, hey, I think what you're saying is wrong. It doesn't line up with what Scripture says. This is what God's Word teaches, and what you're saying is way over here. And if they ignore that and they refuse to repent of that false statement, it says go back to them another time and say, listen, I'm begging you, please, you have to unite and you have to come back to what God's truth says. And if they refuse again to do that and to repent of that sin, so to reject that person. And that sounds hard and that sounds heavy. And at first glance, I think we look at that and we go, that doesn't sound like the church. That doesn't sound like God. So why would Paul be instructing Titus to act this way in these kinds of situations? Listen, I know a lot of people are trying to teach things about Corona right now and this COVID pandemic that we are in. But I think if we really look at it in the right perspective, this season has something to teach us. One of the theories of why this pandemic spread so quickly in the United States is that we were slow on the draw into getting people tested, into taking more severe actions like we've taken in the last few weeks. which is the theory maybe we were too slow to act. It is so harmful, and once it begins to work its way from person to person, if we don't take severe action, it can bring down an entire country. And in a lot of senses, because the pandemic has spread, the entire world has been halted. And yes, our health is important, our lives are important, but guys, the church has a message that is infinitely more important. It is viral for a person inside the church to be allowed to speak untruth, things that oppose what God's word says. It is viral for that person to continue to cause division. And if after being approached a couple of times, that person is unrepentant, we are to have nothing to do with it. I want us to think in the severity of that. I want us to think about an operating room. All of the security protocols, all of the precautions that go into place, all of the sterilizing and very specific steps that a surgeon can lose their entire career over if they don't follow each one of these things carefully and exactly. And the reason that they have all of those rules in place is because they are literally in a life or death situation. And for them to neglect those things and to allow harmful things to enter into that environment could literally cause the death of the person that they're trying to save. And if that's in an operating room, guys, that is the same and multiplied into the church. We are dealing in reality with a life or death situation. Life being salvation from your sin and condemnation to death, and an opportunity to live into eternity in perfection with Jesus, or death and a sentence to hell and a forever eternity spent away from the God that you were designed to be in relationship with. The church is every day in a life and death battle in this world. And if we don't take it seriously and we allow the church to become divisive as it has many times, guys, we have literally the weight of people's lives that will watch how we act and how we treat each other and how the church operates, and they will walk away from the choice of life. Because we did not guard our family and our doors from becoming divisive. And that is why Paul speaks so firmly. We have the most valuable gift to be given. And if that is corrupted, it could lead us and has led many people down the wrong road. And as you feel the weight of that, and we're tempted to start again, like, it's just so heavy. I understand that the church has to act, but what about that person, and how do we deal with that situation, and how am I supposed to sleep knowing that we've done something like this? And verse 11 picks right up with that question. It says, for you know that such a person, that divisive, argumentative, manipulative person that is in the church, such a person has gone astray and is sinning. He is self-condemned. Every believer must be careful not to get caught up in the sin of someone else. One of the biggest reasons that we allow this type of behavior to continue is because we believe that we will feel responsible when that person experiences discipline for their actions. And it's one thing to be empathetic and to hurt, as we should when people walk into sin. Guys, it should hurt us when people make sinful choices. And it's one thing to be empathetic, it's another thing to ignore the situation and to allow it to intensify and turn into something that will hurt more and more people. That is not being a good steward of the mission that God has given us to reconcile. This verse is affirming for us that that person is responsible for their sin, and that person who is unrepentant is responsible for their condemnation. You are not responsible for someone else's sin. You are only responsible for how you respond. Let's say that one more time just to feel the gravity of that. You are not responsible for someone else's decision to choose to walk in sin and defiance of God's truth, but you are responsible for how you respond. Whether you allow that sin to continue without confronting it in the church, without showing grace and a desire for that person to repent. But ultimately, it is clear we are not to allow someone, no matter how badly we want them to repent, if they're refusing, we're not to allow them to destroy the family of the church. Proverbs 13:20 says, "Whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but the companion of fools not will become foolish. The companion of fools will suffer harm." God's warning about this is all through Scripture. Now, guys, as we start to close here at the end, Paul is finalizing the end of this letter. Verse 12, he says, "When I send Artemis or Tychius to you, make every effort, Titus, make every effort to come to me, because I have decided to spend the winter here." All Paul is saying is, listen, I'm on my way to this journey. I want to catch up. Let's reunite. When I send the relief to that area for them to take over, come see me. But until then, he says, all of those who were with me, let me back up. Verse 13, diligently help Zenas the lawyer and Apollos of their journey, so they will lack nothing. I don't know who Zenas the lawyer is, but what a cool title to be known as in Scripture. We know very little about that person, but that sounds awesome. Diligently help them on their journey, so they will lack nothing. And then verse 14, we start to wrap up. It says, let our people learn to devote themselves to good work for pressing needs, so that they will not be unfruitful. I want to pause this right there, guys. This key words to look at this, learn. Guys, we have to learn to devote ourselves to good work. What does that say? It's not of our nature. We are selfish and we are sinful, and our desire is to protect number one first. It says we have to learn to devote ourselves to good work, to help people, to go out of our way and out of our comfort zone to work and make a difference in the world, to do good, to be a good learner. It means you need to be taught. And guys, that's part of this word, and it's part of you diving into your reading, not just coming to church on Sundays, but you diving into God's word and seeing how it is that he commands his people to be learners of how to do good. There's another thing I think we need to pull out of this, is teach the people. Guys, this is all of our responsibility. If you're a believer and you're listening to this message and you're reading this passage, this is your responsibility to do good. Not just your pastor, not just your C group leader, but you and me. It's our responsibility to do good in this world. It is vital that believers learn how to be fruitful and how to model that to others. Vital. Here's another thing. Verse 14 says this, let our people learn to devote themselves to good works for pressing needs, so that they will be, so they will not be unfruitful. Verse 15, all those who are with me send you greetings. Greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be with you all. In that verse 14, one of the words that was phrased at the end is pressing needs. And I think this is really important for us to grasp. Jump in on this. What you want is not always what's needed. What you want to do and what you think would be the most fun is not always what the pressing need is in the community. This corona epidemic has been a great example, because when we heard about this, our church was like, oh my gosh, let's put together baskets and kits and food, and let's get out in the community, and let's take stuff to people's houses, and let's do things for them. And then we started to process that, and like, yeah, but that could be spreading the germs and the disease, and we could be making things worse by doing what our initial reaction was of what we want. And one of the realities is that the pressing need is for us to stay home and to do our due diligence in making sure not to spread this virus. We all want to help, but it's really tricky how, and that's why it's important for us to examine what a pressing need is and distance that from what it is that we may just want as a concept. That's why our church started making phone calls and asking people first, hey, what do you need? And guys, that's one of the ways, and we'll talk about this in a minute, that's why Story Hill has started this relief fund, for you to be able to give to above and beyond our normal giving. Because when the time comes that there's a pressing need, our church wants to be able to respond exactly how we need to help this community. Last thing, guys, and we're going to wrap up. This is tough, and it's heavy. And there's a lot that we all have to weigh in. The first thing you can't do is point your finger at someone else and say, yeah, don't be a divisive person like that person. The first thing we have to do, not blame other people, look inside and see where in your heart you may be causing division and you might be causing strife, and allow God to cut that out of you so that you may be fruitful and able to do good work. I love, though, as challenging as that is, what's the last thing that we hear in this message? Grace be to you all. How good is God to end with grace? Our God has proven time and time again that he desires to show grace to his people. This is from a God who is not cruel and distant and manipulative, but this is from a God who loves you deeply and is more compassionate about your situation than you can ever imagine. Grace to you all. I hope you are encouraged by that. I hope you can take that to heart today, that as you try your very best to live out what God has called us to, that he is looking over you and speaking grace over your life. Be welcome to him and to this mission that we have as the church to be united. Let's pray. God, it is so simple that I do not deserve your grace, but you give it so abundantly. God, what I deserve is death for my sin and my rebellion, but in reality, Lord, you have done so much more, and you have invited me to be an heir to your kingdom and to enter into perfection with you. And God, I don't want to waste the time that I have now. You are the God of the living. You are the God of today. You are the God of my life in this moment and in this moment. And every moment while I breathe, Lord, I want to give my life to you and to doing good and being fruitful for your name, for your church, and for your kingdom. God, humble us and allow us to do all of that in your name and to your glory. Lord, let us praise you as we continue to worship today. It is all in your name.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We look to you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever stand. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my heart. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever stand.
worship Jesus Christ, our King. I hope that you feel the love of God in this moment. I know that it is crazy outside. It's a crazy world. But to come into this little space and to be able to sing God's goodness is just, there's nothing like it. And this next song that we're going to sing is just an anthem of how Jesus has done so much for us. And so I hope that you catch on. I hope that you sing from your homes. You can go grab your own instruments. Just join the fun. You know, make the name of Jesus great. There's no wrong notes when you're singing from the heart. So let's sing together. Thank you.
so excited to be able to share all of this with you this morning, to worship with you. Amen and amen. Couple quick announcements before we get going, okay? First things first, I want us to remember that it is important and it is part of the command to continue to give. But as you give to God's church and to His mission, if there is an ability to give above and beyond this relief fund, what we will be able to use to impact our community, to help love people who have been directly and negatively impacted by the COVID season that we're in. Guys, we want to be able to do that. So you can do that through our website. Also, if ever there's a time to be sure that you're connected to community, now is one of those times. And guys, if you're feeling especially isolated in the midst of all the isolation, it's so important to remember that we have community groups happening still every week, even though it's in an online forum. And it is so good, I know, from my heart and for our staff to see our community and to see their faces and hear their voices week in and week out. It's an encouragement to us. We would love for it to be an encouragement to you. And I have one final announcement that's really cool. We're really excited about it, and we've never done it before, and so you're going to get to experience it with us. For Easter Sunday, we are going to give communion. And that's going to be so different because we won't be in the room together to all hand and share the same things. But what we are going to do is encourage you to get your own bread and your own juice and from your home with all the believers here that are part of this church and in this network across the city, take communion with us on Easter. So you've got a week's notice. Find what you can. Use what you've got around the house. Go to the grocery store if you have to. But be ready to enjoy an amazing communion experience as we celebrate communion and baptism this coming Easter. Guys, we love you so much. Tune in again next week. We can't wait to see you then. Take care.